domínio dos homens pelos segredos que vêm do espaço. Relatos sobre estranhos objetos voadores e sobre seres extraterrestres estão presentes em praticamente todas as culturas. Antecipando a aterrissagem, mostra como, em todo o mundo, centenas de pessoas se preparam para receber os primeiros visitantes de outros planetas. Uma história que já foi contada em inúmeros livros e filmes, alguns de qualidade duvidosa. Fique agora com Antecipando a Aterrissagem.
We're going to benefit if we can ever make contact.
Friendly aliens.
We have no idea what's on.
Starships.
It is the biggest story of all time.
It happened in more than one place in the world.
Probably to occur in Washington, D.C.
in 2001.
I understand from many sources that in the year of 1956 there will be great mass landings, and then the question of flying saucers can no longer be denied.
Flying saucers have invaded our planet. Washington, London, Paris, Moscow are key targets. The whole world is under attack. Can it survive? Never before has the screen reached such heights of excitement, breathtaking spectacle, hair-raising terror. These great cities leveled by flying saucer monsters.
I think it would be just mass panic. Because we see so much. You see so much on TV about all these terrible things, body snatchers and, you know, this kind of thing. And that's the image that people have. And I think that's what would happen. People would just be so afraid.
I probably couldn't get near it. I wouldn't want to get near it because, you know, there'd be all these boneheads running around, you know, just like an accident, you know? The same thing as what happened if there was an accident, a guy was bleeding. Everybody crowd around. Damn traffic, cost problems, so I just sit back as far as possible.
I would probably just stand way over there somewhere and just look, you know, and just see what happens.
Probably run. I got a lot of living to do, and I don't want to be a specimen of any kind.
There would be no more exciting thing that could occur in this Earth than if we were to be visited by creatures from some distant civilization.
I'd probably wet my knickers.
Yes, the world at large is fascinated with so-called flying saucers. However, they do not fly. They oscillate in between dimensions.
Well, now tell me, do you believe these come from outer space?
Oh, very definitely.
Well, whereabouts?
The various planets, we know that they can come from the, say, for example, the Moon, or from Mars, and not too far from the Earth that we know of, and also that they have what you call a mothership, so they can take off from there.
Mm-hmm. I have piloted many spaceships, starships, we call them.
Mm-hmm.
Hello. You're witnessing a rather remarkable phenomena. This is the space car of the future. We are in this manner showing you the reality of the meaning of extraterrestrial intelligence and the arrival of space craft and the brothers who are upon these craft from other planes, Earth planes similar to our plane here. Unarius, this organization, a vast brotherhood of advanced human beings who are concerned for man's spiritual evolvement, was founded by Dr. Ernest and Ruth E. Norman in 1954.
I am Uriel, the director and founder of this organization, Unarius. Our mission is to teach people that whatever man has done in the past, good, bad, or indifferent, he will repeat it in the present. Man lives forever. There is no such thing as death. He may change different bodies, which I expect to very soon. You may call it die. Leave this body. I have lived in this body 90 years. I was born in 1900.
The cosmic generator is a way of trying to tell mankind that an infinite mind that has incarnated as Uriel, through her energy and understanding, is able to and does sustain the planets, and the little lights that going from one planet to another are symbolic of the electromagnetic fields of energy that are a part of an infinite mind that sustain these planets in their orbits. And also, energy is constantly in motion and constantly regenerating itself, as you might think of it as perpetual motion.
Body, every soul, whether he knows it or not, is working to become a space brother where he can teach and lead others.
Do you believe in flying saucers yourself?
Oh, very definitely.
You ever seen any?
Yes, I saw one about 3-4 weeks ago.
Whereabouts?
At 13th Street and 6th Avenue.
Right here in New York.
That's correct.
The sky is the stage, the actors, so-called flying saucers. Suddenly, the Air Force takes off to intercept unexplained objects in the sky over Washington. Despite the appearance of the supposed saucers on radar, the planes draw a blank. But at other points, there's a flurry of saucer sighting incidents. Maybe the puzzling objects are from another planet or from an enemy here on Earth.
Not that I can think of. Maybe a couple friends that claim they have on Saturday night, but...
There is something out there. Whether or not it's extraterrestrial, I think we will probably only find out when they want us to find out.
They are not going to be unknown much longer. The Sasanis are coming in. I think they're 5 to 15,000 years ahead of us. They channel through a man in San Fernando Valley, and his name is Bashar.
I believe personally that
These people exist. I have seen them. I know their ships are in our atmosphere. I've seen those too.
They come from the bowels of hell, a transformed race of walking dead, zombies guided by a master plan for complete domination of the Earth. Plan 9 from outer space.
Turn off your electro gun! No! No! Stop him, Dennis!
I can't get it, it's jammed!
Stop him, you fool!
To help us. And also, in Salon 3, the system that we are in, if we blow this planet like they did in Maldek, which is now the asteroid belt, it would throw the whole works out of balance. So it's a self-protective interest as well as a helpful one.
We could be being observed, you know. I'd imagine that something's watching. I remember feeling that I was being watched, and the only place I could look was up, you know, just from reaction. I'm allergic to these things.
And in this particular solar system, we do not rank very highly. In fact, we're rather an ordinary speck of dust as a planet. But we are progressing. We're doing things. And for that reason, we must have this outside help, this additional education.
They want mankind to go forward. And so when it's the right time, they will land. And it will be karmically correct for them to do so.
This is the American headquarters of the Aetherius Society in Los Angeles, California. The Aetherius Society is a religious, educational, non-profit organization which has, for the past 36 years, been responsible for disseminating the messages received through its founder president, Sir George King, from cosmic intelligences who man the craft we call flying saucers. And most importantly, upon acting on these messages.
With all our heart and soul, let us join together in holy mantra. Om Mani Padme Hum. Om Mani Padme Hum. Om Mani Padme Hum.
My name is Alan Mosley, and I'm a priest in the Aetherius churches. I work both during the day and during the evening, as do many of our other volunteer staff. They volunteer their time in the evening to help in this particular cause. I consider myself to be ordinary in that, you know, if necessary, I'll eat meat or I'll drive a car. We don't withdraw from life. I'll even watch a television program. I mean, goodness gracious. Members of the Aetherius Society are ordinary people, and they do not claim to be extraterrestrials or have individual contact with extraterrestrials. What makes us a little extraordinary is just what we do. Other people find it unusual.
Almighty Father of all creation, flow in this world now. Let it shine into the hearts and minds of men now. May look within and see the glory of thine everlasting being. O Spirit of Spirits, let your love flow through the hearts and minds of man now, so that he may...
The message of the cosmic intelligences is that man has not been put on this earth to suffer, but that his state at this present time is the result of his own wrong thought and action. These intelligences can't take away our negative karma, but they can show us how to transmute it through spiritual action. The cosmic masters have gone out of their way to give us the most potent tools in these days to help our world.
See the glory.
Listen.
are they who work
on
many.
We released one particular battery in 74 to bring about peace on the little island of Cyprus, where you had both Greece and Turkey ready to start a major war. We released one battery. Within hours of that release, a ceasefire was declared.
Only look within, see the glory.
My first contact was May of last year, 1954. I was hurrying to catch the bus to go home in the early evening when I suddenly bumped into the back of a tall man dressed in a brown suit. He stood there for just a few moments, then suddenly disappeared. This was very frightening at first, but I have had the experience several times since, and the same thing has happened. One evening, last August, 1954, Brother Bacco came to my trailer and told me he would like to take me to the planet Venus. As we went to the door to go out, I saw the most beautiful little illuminous ship sitting in my drive right in back of my car. I had never seen such a gorgeous piece of artwork anywhere. Brother Bacco touched the ship and three little steps came out. We immediately went within, only to see the most beautiful white quilted material covering the entire interior of the ship. We sat down, I on Brother Bacco's right. We immediately left the earth, and as you folks would know, as I was completely overwhelmed at the suddenness of all this. It was very hard to comprehend. Very suddenly, we went into a tailspin, but we arrived on the planet Venus.
If we choose to accept the offers of our advanced space brothers, then they will share their wisdom and their knowledge and their science with us. This unique structure behind me is known as the Integraton, or the Dome, and was built under guidance of the Space Bean by George W. Van Tassel. It was began in the late 1950s and is still not completed. When it is completed, if ever, then it should have the characteristics of creating a unique time field that would restore missing parts of the body, such as missing arms and legs. They have done demonstrations and experiments where animals missing various limbs and so on have been restored by this unique time field within the small-scale demonstration structures. When one goes inside the dome and stands directly in the center of the building, one receives very unique vibrations that raise the consciousness of all the people within the interior of the dome, and oftentimes sends them into an altered state of consciousness. And one time when I was here with a group, where we were standing, we were standing around the edges of the building, and it seemed like the whole building was going to lift off.
I'm Evan Hayworth. I'm a designer here in sunny California. I design all kinds of things, tools, games, toys. This is my company car. I use it to take a model of the solar system around to various schools. The basic car itself was a 62 Falcon left to me by my dear father. And I was taking it unadorned to schools, lecturing them on the solar system. And somehow we got to talking about cars. And finally, somebody said, "What kind of car do you drive?" I said, "Well, I drive an old Falcon." And this boy was on his feet. "Ooh, ooh, ooh, is that the Falcon the guy drives in Star Wars?" And I thought, aha, no, no, it's not. But can you give me a couple of weeks? And he said, "What?" And I said, "Never mind." And 2 weeks later, I showed up at the school with it looking like this.
I would say that if anybody had a mind to, they could probably dress up a car of either similar vintage or later vintage. And since it is an old car, it's going to need some parts, one specifically for the engine, before I can get it running again. But once I do, why, then I'm going to be back on the road taking the solar system around Los Angeles.
And I think we can call you a Venusian, is that right, Miss Hayden?
Well, I rather like the planet Venus, but I wouldn't say that you could call me a Venusian. I think I'm just right here on Earth.
Venusian by adoption. How do I know you're not one of these people wandering around?
Well, maybe you wouldn't know, but I would know.
Oh, I see.
Naturally, we are very curious to know where it is you come from.
From another planet. Let's just say that we're neighbors.
You're a long way from home, aren't you, Mr. Carpenter?
How did you know?
Oh, I can tell a New England accent a mile away.
That I don't know. But I do believe they're making contact in whatever form or shape they take.
And there have been a lot of people that I've read for who have actually seen flying saucers coming out of the ocean, literally beneath Baja California.
Some have said they come from within the Earth, but I fully believe they're from outer space.
I found evidence that we discovered alien bases on the moon.
It gives life a little more dimension to think that there's some other life out there. Yeah. And I know there's a lot of people to say there's visitors from other places.
So they just keep us in check by appearing every now and then. And they keep us in check. If we go over a little overboard, then they'll make sure we don't. That's my belief.
Have you ever seen a saucer yourself?
No. The only one I've seen is the one I built. That's probably why I built it.
I'm Henry DiCienzo, owner of Flying Saucer Restaurant, situated in Niagara Falls, Ontario. All my life I've been fascinated by UFOs. My greatest dream is to have an encounter of the third kind, in the hope that they may answer all the questions that have baffled me all my life.
Have you ever had any alien visitors?
Aliens? Some weirdos, yeah. One thing that people have commented after one is that they're attracted by the lights, the colored lights.
I'd like to realize one more dream. I would like to create one huge flying saucer and the same construction as ferro cement, with the exception of having skylights on a roof instead of the solid cement, and to put it in a natural rocky terrain, elevated maybe 15, 20 feet from the elevation, and it would truly look like a UFO has landed. The looks would definitely be mind-boggling, more like a disco-type setting with all its colors and costumes for the waitresses and special drinks and saucer dogs and Saturn rings, whatever, complement decor. I would hope that if I ever built one, my dream comes true, that they would be mistaken for a mothership or their mothership, and hopefully land beside it, and it'll answer all my questions. Finally, we meet Earth and space. That's what I would really like to see.
You know, somebody might think that you're disappointed in not finding some horrible beast from another planet.
I can't get over the awful feeling that this is the calm and that the storm is going to break out any minute.
I understand that they can mingle quite freely with the human beings on this planet and not be recognized.
They look like human beings?
Well, they are human beings. They just happen to come from a different background, so to speak, different environment.
There's no reason why they shouldn't, you know, look like a fork.
There are some that are a little strange looking. However, those are not necessarily the majority of them.
The large eyes, or as Barney called them, wraparound eyes.
Some of them have three eyes. Some of them have small mouths.
A little tiny nose. Thin slit for the mouth.
They would have maybe pointed ears?
No protruding part of the ears. No hair. and a gray tone to the skin.
You don't want to do business with the Greys, which are trying to do business with our government, fence riders, are the Blacks, these are labels only, but only with those that are willing to do battle to try to keep us free.
You see, a craft, you say, hi, boys. You know, this type of thing. Be friendly. They're a long ways away from home.
Well, I would hope they weren't selling anything. Beyond that, seriously, I think, since if all the signs of it were peaceful coming to my door, I guess I would seek communication with them and hope for the best.
When we arrived home in the morning, about 5 o'clock, the first thing that we noticed was the trip had taken us much longer than it should have, at least 2 hours. Both our watches had stopped running. The tops of Barney's shoes were scuffed. The strap on his new binoculars was broken. My dress was torn. And later in the day, we found highly polished spots on the trunk of the car.
When we first heard about UFOs, it took us 20 years to decide that these things may have an inside, that there may be somebody inside piloting them or whatnot. We couldn't accept the idea of an abduction, even when we heard about the Betty Hill case. I certainly couldn't. And when we finally, reluctantly, were dragged kicking and screaming by the evidence itself to accept the fact that the Hills had been taken aboard, this had happened, there was absolutely no way to reject it.
When this story first broke, it was unexpected. All of a sudden, one day, there it was, front page of the newspapers, ran for the front pages for 5 days. We had to go to the store and buy the newspaper to see what was being published about us. Bonnie was standing out in the field looking up at this craft, and he could see the big picture window and the red lights on each side. He could see this group of humanoid-like figures looking down at him, and one of them was saying to him, "Don't be afraid. No harm's going to come to you. You're not going to be harmed. Just stay there."
Barney, wake up. If Barney is safe, and I wouldn't answer. And then the leader, "There's no reason to be afraid. We just want to do some tests. And then when the tests are over, we'll take you and Barney back to your car. You'll be on your way back home in no time." And then come to a clearing. And there was, I wish it were light so I could get a better picture of it.
After my examination was completed, the man we call the examiner went into the room with Barney, and this, I'm alone now in the room with the leader. And I said to him, "I would like to have something to take back with me to prove this really happened." There was a book there, and he said I could have this. But one of the crew members started yelling and carrying on, and so the leader took the book back.
"I won't forget about it. You can take the book, but you can never, never, never make me forget." "I'll remember if it's the last thing I do."
I wish I'd asked them the purpose for being here. That would have solved a lot of problems and mysteries, but I didn't. And this is one of the reasons why I go out to observe.
Well, the Air Force takes a dim view of this flying saucer business, or so we gather here in the outside world.
Well, actually, the Air Force takes quite an
intense interest
in this flying saucer business, because actually these flying objects are supposed to actually be violating airspace.
A press conference hears the Air Force intelligence chief declare that of 2,000 reports of saucers, most of those considered reliable can be satisfactorily explained, and the rest are no threat to the nation, says Major General James Samford.
We have, as of date, come to only one firm conclusion with respect to this remaining percentage, and that is that it does not contain any pattern of purpose or of consistency that we can relate with any conceivable threat to the United States.
I work every day as a federal employee in a five-sided building that has its own problems. When I depart the building, it's like Superman changing into Clark Kent or vice versa, so that I can feel free to live a double life, essentially. I'm Larry W. Bryant here in Alexandria, Virginia, where I operate the Washington, D.C. office of a group called Citizens Against UFO Secrecy, formed in the late 1970s to investigate what the government knows and when it knew it about UFO reality. Something crash-landed in New Mexico in 1947, leaving debris, bodies apparently, of the occupants, snatched up by military authorities, spirited away for intelligence analysis of whatever was found on the alien bodies recovered. Roswell stands as the answer to basically what the government has been doing for 40 years. Analyzing the scene back in 1983, I decided to escalate public awareness of the issue by filing what I called a petition for a writ of habeas corpus extraterrestrial. In my petition, I sought to have the remains, bodies, they don't have to be human bodies, of allegedly crash-landed flying saucers presented to the court for proper disposition. Well, it didn't go far because of some technicality. In a catch-22 characterization, I could not show the current whereabouts of the bodies at issue, so therefore the court had no choice but to grant the government's motion for dismissal. I've been involved in a few other lawsuits. For example, a few months ago, actually, over a year ago, I filed a Freedom of Information lawsuit against the Federal Bureau of Investigation. I did lose that suit. On the other hand, that did not deter me from going ahead with the next lawsuit. The latest lawsuit I filed against the Central Intelligence Agency over one document that refers to me. If there are no such things, flying saucers, why do these agencies feel compelled to withhold information on their activities as regards UFO researchers and UFO encounters? If Americans cannot criticize their government, then we're in more trouble, perhaps, than if we were being invaded by alien visitors.
Here come the Martian, and they're riding on their Martian bike. Well, we have to find out right now, what kind of ice cream do the Martians like? Well, here come the Martian, why stay in such a cheap hotel? Maybe we should help out the Martians. Looks like the Martians, they do it too well. Martian time. Well, it's Martian rhyme time. We got a Martian rhyme for Martian time. And the Martians got no books in their little hands. Well, it's strange as it is land. Martian time. It's Martian, Martian time. Gentlemen, tell them all about it.
I am Jules Van Brabant of St. Paul, Alberta. I was born and raised in St. Paul. In 1967, I was the mayor when we decided to build this landing pad. The idea behind this landing pad is, frankly, to welcome everybody from this earth and also extraterrestrial beings, if there are any, and we hope there are.
What we are explaining now is the landing of spacecraft in 2001. And as they land, you will note that they will be stacked up one upon another. And as they land and are stacked up together, they will be sealed permanently, electronically, so that when all 33 ships are sealed, they will be about 2.5 miles high. And there will be 33,000 volunteer scientists of all of the avenues of knowledge that will be here.
But the most wonderful part about their coming is not really that they are coming, but they are going to remain and live here all of their lives. Can you imagine that?
Uriel, our great teacher, is called by the brothers themselves who are coming in the spacecraft, the space fleet commander, and her spacecraft will be on top of the 32 spacecraft.
I carry the same power that our dear brother Jesus of Nazareth carried, and he turned over to me his love and light with the commendation, carry on from here, carry on my mission. I know you will do well. But I don't believe that he ever expected us, and I say us, to do all that we have.
Come with me through this tunnel of stars. Here you will find worlds of cosmic love to which there is no end. Never, never forget the pathway to the stars.
Yes, I would. Of course, depending on my schedule. No, actually, I would go. I don't think I'd have really any fear of going with somebody out there. I figure it's going to be, even if I died, it would be the most interesting experience I'm likely to ever have.
I don't really think I would just want to go out of space just like that. Going to the park, going there, I don't know the language where they speak. I don't have anybody that I would be able to communicate with there to make my life happy. So I wouldn't definitely want to go.
Well, I'd really have to think about that, because what if you didn't come back?
They're going to catch me, then take me, and they're going to take me fighting and kicking and scratching all the way.
I would love to talk to them.
I would love to see what's going on.
Yeah,
I would go.
I'd be out like here. We're really missing much here if we need.
Yeah, yeah.
If communications were established, I'd go along. I'd ask them, take me a spin around the moon.
Where would you like to take me? I get my mother to feed my cats. Why, you can take me all the way to Zeta Reticulum if you want.
The two of you are beginning a strange journey. A journey that no Earth people have ever undertaken before.
You'll marvel at the superior intelligence that unleashes its deadly ray, or can kidnap an airplane in flight.
It depends on your cultural background on what kind of abduction you report. In England, they're very similar. The craft lands, politely invites the person to go on board, and once they're on board, they ask them if they'd like to go on a little trip, which they agree to, and they come back, and when they release them, they thank them for their cooperation and wish them a good day. That's English. Now, Brazil. Oh, in England, too. The beings are described as looking like us. Now, in Brazil, it's mostly men who get abducted. The men are treated roughly. They're asked many questions regarding sex, and they're thrown out. And usually, they describe the beings as looking like us, although many times, these beings are accompanied by a short, furry creature. Now, in the United States, we have a mixture of everybody. All kinds of creatures go around kidnapping Americans, from little tiny dwarfs up to 6'6", tall, blonde, blue-eyed, handsome men with long, white, flowing robes. All kinds of creatures looking like insects. One woman told of being captured by Batman.
My experience is but a small part in this great plan. The Venetians are here among us with great love. Believe me, there are many more to come. Their purpose is to help us in this world crisis. Their influence is very great, as you will see. You are going to be able to meet these people, to talk with them, as well as take part in a trip to their planet. Believe me, for I know it is so.
Lots of people, I guess, want to get away from all the horror that's going on around them and try and escape from it. And I guess they're looking upwards because they feel that's where the good will come from. To get away from it all.
Do you feel that's where it will come from? From somewhere?
From up there, yes, definitely. Yeah.
I have a burning desire to get into space, and the burning desire that I have is so deep that it almost feels like it's confirmation that there's alien life out there.
We have an interest in alien life, and I'm sure alien life would have an interest in us. All we have to do is be able to make contact with them and tap into their knowledge.
Have you looked at the night sky without an awareness that there's more out there than we can ever hope to understand? Things we might sense if we weren't too stupid to admit their existence.
We have had contact with the benevolent beings, the more advanced beings that made contact with Earthlings here in the early 50s and 60s. Oftentimes I've felt like I've been, I'm maybe 50 years ahead of my time, and 43 of them have gone by already. We hope that we're not more than 50 years ahead of our time, and that mankind will have been prepared to accept the reality of the extraterrestrials and the benefits that they are here to offer our civilization.
We live in peace, without arms or armies, secure in the knowledge that we are free from aggression and war, free to pursue more profitable enterprises. We do not pretend to have achieved perfection, but we do have a system, and it works.
They could change our whole way of life. I mean, they must have resolved a lot of their problems in order to progress to the point of being able to come here and to stay here. Look at that science. And they must have abolished death, or at least have extremely long lives. So they have great medical advances. And they, you know, if they're coming here, they've probably been to other star systems. I mean, it could take us out of, we're almost like in the Stone Age compared with them. Look what it could do for us.
Do you think that day will come?
They're already here. I've been asked the question occasionally, since I see so many UFOs, the possibility that I attract them. And I would say the answer is definitely no. Because I know where they go, and I go where they are to observe them. I have a certain signal that I give as identification.
Do you get any responses back?
Yeah.
Do you think they know who you are?
I think so.
Do they see you as a friend, do you think?
I think so. In fact, I've told them, point blank, they better be good to me. I may be the only friend they have on this planet.
If people think I'm nuts, that it doesn't really bother me. I won't let that persuade me away from my work or my cause, as I feel it as a vision. As an artist has a vision, I have a vision. I search and I seek, and I'm not about to give up that search for any reason.
They may already be visiting this world. I am sending out music from here to try to make more direct contact. I think music expresses the human element very well, the human spirit, the human feelings and emotions are well transmitted in music, quality music, of course, but music nevertheless.
And this is Project Strat Earth Station 1, your Northern Michigan's only alternative ULF creative music station. We're now going to bring you some Afropop to warm up your evening. Everything isn't hopeless, and the world isn't totally doomed and all this. I guess I hear a lot of gloom and doom today. But, I believe the message is hope. The message is encouragement of creativity, of spirit, of being and growth, and the awareness of others, and the awareness of what might be beyond this world as well.